Test. 1, 2, 1, 2. Test. 1, 2.
Ready? Good morning, Life Point.
Good morning.
All right. Oh, y'all are a rowdy crowd this morning. That's good. We like rowdy around here, right? So anyway, we're so glad to see you this morning. Thank you for being here, and we're excited to see you. Hey, buddy. And welcome. I hope you've had a good week. Some of us are talking, it seems like to me, this week has just flown by. And I hope you've had a good week, and your week has flown by in a good, positive way. So anyway, that brings us back to another Lord's Day and another beginning of a week. And so we're so thankful that you're here. Thanks for being a part of our service today. And if you are visiting with us for the very first time, you're our special guest, and we welcome you. And you should have gotten a welcome packet, and I hope you'll take a moment to fill out the card that's in the welcome packet and just drop that in the offering plate or leave it on your seat when you leave today. But we're so glad that you're here. Thank you for being a part of our service today. Let me share some announcements with you. Don't forget about life groups. We have four or five life groups that are going on now. And if you have questions about that, you can see Brother Gary back there or see myself. We have a young adult group that meets on Tuesday nights at 6 o'clock. And we have a new seniors group that meets at Brother Duncan and Ms. Kay's home on Wednesday nights at 6:30. And then we have other groups that meet during the week. And so if you're not part of a life group, let me encourage you to get a part of one and grow in the Lord and grow in your relationships with other people here in the church. You'll find it, I think, to be a really cool experience for you. So if you have any questions, just let me know about that. Also, this month, we are going to have our dedication Sunday. We're planning that for the 28th of April. We're planning to have a special service that Sunday, and then we're planning to eat afterwards here on the grounds. And so we want you to just encourage you to put that on your calendar. On the 28th of this month, the last Sunday of April, we'll be having our dedication Sunday for our new building here, and just to thank God for what He's doing in our hearts and in our lives here. So don't forget about that. Stick that on your calendars. Also, the next Sunday, which I think is May the 3rd or 4th, I can't remember the exact date, but it's the following Sunday after 28th, we have a special concert. Eric Horner will be with us. Most of the time we hear Eric around Christmas, but he's going to be in the area, and he had an open date, and so he's going to be with us on that first Sunday of May, I think it's the 3rd or 4th. And he'll be with us in concert that Sunday. So I hope you'll put that on your calendars as well and join us. Eric's always a lot of fun, great, great talent, and a great witness for the Lord. So I hope that you'll remember that, be here for that as well. So I think that's all the announcements except for one. Softball season is upon us, and we have a softball meeting for everyone who signed up, or if you would like to play and you haven't signed up yet, if you'll meet with Tim. We'll meet right up here at the front after the service. And so if you have signed up or if you're interested in softball, we're asking you to meet right after the service right up here. And Tim has some information for you. So,
that's right.
Yes, ma'am.
Team revival started Thursday night in Newport.
Okay.
Across the street from town hall.
Oh, okay.
Thursday through Saturday it starts at 7 and Sunday it starts at 5.
Okay. Okay. All right. Thank you for that. Student Revival beginning in Newport this coming week. All right. So keep that as well in your minds if you would like to attend that. So let me share a passage of Scripture with you as we begin our service this morning. From Psalm 84, listen to what the psalmist says here. For a day in your courts is better than 1,000 outside. I would rather stand at the threshold of the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord gives grace and glory. No good thing does He withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, how blessed is the man who trusts in You. And so we're here to dwell in the courts of the Lord this morning, amen, and to worship and adore Him. So let's stand together, if you will, before we have our call to worship this morning by our praise team, and let's ask God to bless us as we meet together this morning to share around the table of His Word. Let's pray. Father, we want to thank You so much for the opportunity this hour today to gather corporately and to worship You as one body of believers. Lord, we thank You for every church that's meeting this morning who honors the Word of God and who honors the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we pray that You would just bless this time together as we meet and as You minister to us. Lord, may our worship, Lord, may our commitment to you to live the kind of life that pleases you be pleasing to you this morning as we gather, as we worship, and then as we disperse. Father, we pray your blessings upon our praise team this morning. We pray your blessings over them and their work as they lead us in worship. Lord, for our children's ministry, we thank you for that great work and what you're doing in that regard. For our student work, Lord, that happens on Sunday afternoons after our service here. And Father, all the different ministries that go on as a part of LifePoint Church, our Smart Recovery and Grief Share, and the Life Groups and our Shepherd's Hand Ministry. Father, we just thank you for each one of those ministries, Lord, and the individual efforts that each one makes throughout the week. And so, God, we just pray now that your Spirit would just dwell powerfully and richly in this place. And Lord, may you be honored and glorified, and may those needs that are present today be met through the power of your grace. We ask it all in Jesus' sweet name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's remain standing for our call to worship. Some of that holy water. If you don't, we'll have it by the time we finish today. Amen. Amen. All right. If you will, turn around, shake a hand, hug a neck for a few moments, and at the alrighty then, we'll resume. Before we have our offering this morning, we're going to hear from someone very, very special. This young man you met last week, if you haven't met him before, and get y'all's attention. Get your attention. We're going to have something very special this morning before we move on to the rest of the service. But this young man we met last week when he was baptized, and that was Trail. And he asked if he could share his testimony, and the Lord has brought this young man through a lot in his life, and Trail's going to come this morning and share with us what God has laid on his heart and just kind of help us to be aware of the redeeming power, the redeeming grace of our God. Trail, good to see you, buddy.
Hey, guys.
Hello?
Is that it? That's it.
All right. I typed my testimony up on my phone, so I'm reading it off my phone. In the depths of drug addiction and evolving gang life, I found myself lost and hurting others and constantly on the wrong side of the law. I was immersed in the world of violence, robbing people, even shooting at others. It seemed that there was no way out. I felt trapped in a cycle of darkness. However, my journey to redemption was not without challenge. I have been in and out of prison, serving time for crimes I committed. Each time I found myself behind bars and I faced the harsh reality of my actions and the consequences that I have brought upon myself and others. It was during this difficult moment that I clenched faith and found solitude in the Lord's presence, even within the confines that God loved me, even through the pain I have caused. I profoundly turned my life around. I realized he loved me by getting the girl of my dreams, and after all the wrong I was doing, he still blessed me with that. It sparked a desire for me to change my life and leave the gang life alone in the destructive path I've been on. I sought redemption and forgiveness, knowing that only through God's faith could I find true transformation. Today I stood before y'all as a living testimony in the power of the Lord, as God's love and the possibility of redemption. How he has taken a life with darkness and transformed it into one of hope and light. I am no longer defined by my past mistakes, but rather by the grace that has been bestowed upon me. My story serves as a reminder that no matter how far astray you go, God never gives up on us. He offers forgiveness, healing, and change, and the chance of a new start. It is my faith that my testimony will inspire others to believe in the transformation of God's love and find solitude in his unwavering presence, regardless of the mistakes that they have made in their past roads.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Trail. What a powerful, powerful testimony. And how much that means to all of us, doesn't it? Because you know what? All of us have been broken, and all of us have been in need of a Savior, haven't we? And thank God for Trail. Trail, bless you, buddy. Bless you. Well, at this time, we're going to receive our offering, and we will give you an opportunity to share this morning. And thank you for sharing. Thank you for giving. And just thank you for what you've done in that way of financial stewardship to this church, and then what we do with that money, not only locally in our own church, but around the world. that are giving through our Southern Baptist Co-op movement. So let's pray and ask God's blessing on our offering. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to give today. And Lord, thank you that as Trail just illustrated for us, that you teach us how to give because of your giving. You have given us grace. You have given us freedom. You have given us redemption. And so, Father, I pray that in light of what we have received from you, that we would in turn be faithful stewards, not just of our finances, Father, but of our strength, our energy, our talents, our time. Father, may we be good stewards of all of those things as we seek to serve you, worship you, and be a pleasing sight to your eyes. We pray now that you would bless the gift and the giver. For us in Jesus' sweet name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may come and share your gifts. Jared, can I use your mic a second? One of the things I forgot this morning, TJ, just a second. One of the things I forgot to mention this morning, I don't know how many of you are aware of it or not, but Miss Tammy Thomas was nominated for Woman of the Year. And she, she's She's not here today because she's in California, on her way to California. Yeah, I dropped her off this morning at the airport, and she's on the way to California to, I guess, in a way, compete for that. She's been nominated, and so let's pray for her safety, and I can't think of anyone who's more deserving of that than Miss Tammy. So let's keep her in our prayers as she's in California for that. Some fun things happening. And then TJ has a testimony he wants to share with us real quickly.
It's not really a testimony.
It's on.
It's not really a testimony, but I worked as a correctional corporal at a maximum security prison for 2.5 years. And in that 2.5 years, I saw 3 inmates on the outside afterwards, after they got let go. And only 2 of them out of the 3, I saw one re-involve himself in the life of crime that he was in. And I told him that I was disappointed in him. And he said, yeah, man, I know, but this is my life. And I was like, man, you can change it. The other 2 I saw, they changed their life. And just like Trail here, he decided to take the path of God. He figured out how to turn it around. And I just want to say that I'm super proud of you, man. I made it known to those other 2 inmates that I saw on the outside. When they had changed their life and they had done, the first one I saw, I got volunteered to go to a job fair as a correctional corporal to try to recruit people to work at the prison. And I saw one of the inmates there trying to get a job. And I asked him, I said, how you doing, man? How you been since you got out? And he says, well, I'm not gonna lie to you. I did get high, all that stuff. He's like, but I stopped it. He's like, I knew I wouldn't be able to go back that life and I would end up where I was before. And he said, so I'm here today at this job fair trying to get a job, trying to straighten my life out. And I said, look, man, I'm gonna shake your hand. You know, I'm super proud of you. You know, you're trying to turn yourself around, and you're doing it, man. It takes a lot of strength, and God was there to give you that strength to do it. And so I'm really, really happy for you. And
amen.
I just want to say a lot of times, even though you change your life, you don't get that acknowledgement. And I just want to say I'm super proud of you, man. And you're a blessing.
Amen. Amen. Okay. Thank you, buddy.
I'm probably not the only turd that's been turned into fertilizer. I'm sorry for that pun. But I love my turds, bro. Let's fertilize Carter County and be the disciples we want. Hey, my story. Perfect song for this. I love you guys. Congrats, brother. I love you.
You guys are standing and join us.
Oh, yeah, you can do that too.
If I told you my story, would hear hope and would let go. And if I told you my story, you would hear love and never gave up. And if I told you my story, you would hear life. It wasn't mine. If I should sing, then let it be of the grace that is greater than all my sin. But when justice was served, and when mercy went, of the kindness of Jesus, was one for me. And if I
story. You would hear life overcome the grave. If I should speak, then let it be of the grace that is greater than all my sin. But when justice was served and when mercy went, of the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of me. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Come on, church. This is my story. All the day long. For the grace that is greater than all my sin. Of when justice was served and when mercy went. Of the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of the grace that is greater than all my sin. Of when justice was served and when mercy went. Of the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of Him. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
I'm glad to see JR this morning because I thought I was going to have to do that song this morning and I messed it up pretty bad Wednesday night with practice. But JR's been in the hospital and we're thankful to have him back. Pray for him. And we're all fighting allergies, me and Jill and whatever, but God's good, and He's bringing us through, so thank you.
All the time, God is good.
Lord bless you and make His face shine upon me, be gracious to you. Lord, turn His face toward you and give you peace. Lord, bless you. His face shine upon me, be gracious to you. Lord, turn His face toward you and give peace. Thank you.
His favor be upon you in a thousand generations. Your family, your children, your children, your children. His favor be upon you in a thousand generations. Your family, your children, your children,
their children.
His favor.
Thousand stories of what they think you're like. I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night. You tell me that you'll please it and I'm never alone. You're a good father. It's who you are. Who you are, who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. I've seen many searching for answers far and wide. I know we're all searching. Good Father, it's who you are, it's who you are,
Amen. I love the songs that we've sung this morning for worship, don't you? Powerful songs. Let me just ask you a question, though. How many of you, in all honesty, have struggled with, because these last two songs remind us of something that is really important, and that is God is for us, as the Amen, the blessing song went, and the last song, that God is a good, good Father. How many of you have struggled with that concept in your life? I know a lot of us have. It's hard for us to think about a God who is holy and righteous and sovereign being for us and loving us, and yet I want you to know that He does. And one of the things that we're going to be looking at as we begin a new series on the Holy Spirit today is to understand, and I pray that the Holy Spirit will help us to understand just how much He really does love us, because He truly does love us and He cares for us. And sometimes it's hard for us to wrap our minds around it, but by the Spirit's help, we can, and we can enjoy what that means in our lives. And so if you have your Bibles, let me ask you to turn to Acts chapter 19. We're going to look at verses 1 through 7. This is sort of a different passage, I guess, to look at when you start thinking about the person of the Holy Spirit. But I think it's a great passage for us to begin with in looking at this monumental subject and person of the Trinity. Acts chapter 19, verses 1 through 7 shows us Paul is in Ephesus, and he is getting ready to talk to some folks here who, although were probably Christians, did not understand or had not received everything that God wanted them to receive at this time. And so in Acts chapter 19, verses 1 through 7, listen to what Luke writes here. He says, "It happened that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul passed through the upper country and came to Ephesus and found some disciples. He said to them, 'Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?'" Now, for us, that's a new question today. The role of the Holy Spirit, the ministry of the Holy Spirit, has changed. But at this particular juncture, Paul asked this question about their relationship to the Holy Spirit and what that meant to them. And so they said to him, "No, we have not even heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." And he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" And they said, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in him who was coming after him, that is, in Jesus." Now, you remember, if you go back to John the Baptist and his role, what was his role? He was the forerunner of Christ. And you remember that when he preached in the wilderness, he said, you know, that someone greater after me is coming, and I'm baptizing you in the name and judgment. But when Jesus comes, he's going to baptize you. He's going to baptize you as in power and strength of the Holy Spirit. And so now Paul is kind of catching them up to date on these doctrinal theological changes, if you will. So it says that when they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they began speaking with tongues and prophesying. There were in all about 12 men. So many believers today, beloved, unfortunately, are like the believers in our text. If they are aware of the Holy Spirit at all, they may gravitate toward two erroneous positions. Some reduce the Holy Spirit to an it, making him little more than some irrelevant Star Wars type force. You know, May the 4th is coming. And this little cliche that's developed out of that, "May the 4th be with you." That's kind of the idea that has been degenerated into who the Holy Spirit is. There are some groups, actually, that teach that the Holy Spirit is not a person. It is simply an it, or some type of power, some type of authority, but they relegate the Holy Spirit to something that is inanimate, not into the third person of the Godhead. And so that's one of the extremes that we see. Another extreme that we see is an overemphasis and misunderstanding of the person and the role of the Holy Spirit. And here is, we just get overemphasized on him, and we begin to make doctrines and to make experiences on the Holy Spirit and his work in our lives that is outside of the scope of Scripture. And so there we kind of veer off course in that regard too. Unfortunately, the words of the great A.W. Tozer still ring true today. A.W. Tozer once said this. He says, if the Holy Spirit was withdrawn from the church today, 95% of what we do would go on, and no one would know the difference. If the Holy Spirit had been withdrawn from the New Testament church, 95% of what they did would stop, and everybody would know the difference. Now, that's quite a commentary on where we are today, because we have, again, subjugated, we have relegated the Holy Spirit and his ministry plumb out of our lives, so to speak. And we don't really look at him, and we don't really put him as an emphasis in our lives in the way that we should. So I believe it's crucial to properly understand the Holy Spirit, understand who he is, and then based on that understanding, to release him to do the work in our lives and churches as he desires to do. I want you to understand, we do not want to be afraid of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our comforter. The Holy Spirit is our paraclete. The Holy Spirit is our guide. The Holy Spirit is God. And we want to understand the Holy Spirit, and then we want to get ourselves out of the way and allow the Holy Spirit to do in our lives and in our churches as he so chooses to do. Wouldn't that be a novel idea? We don't want to be in that 95% that Tozer mentioned, that if the Holy Spirit was withdrawn, we'd never know the difference. Because I'm going to tell you something, the Spirit is in this place. He is at work in this place. When you listen to testimonies like Trail, you can't, listen, I'm in the substance use work, and I'm in the mental health counseling work, but I'm going to tell you something, outside of an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ, I think recovery is very slim to none in many cases. Because it is the power, it is the working of the Holy Spirit in our lives that gives us the authority to do what we need to do in our lives. So let's begin by understanding who the Holy Spirit is. First of all, he is a person. The Holy Spirit possesses the characteristics of a person. Now, we're going to be looking at a lot of passages today. Probably most of them will be on your screen. But let me encourage you, too, to bring your Bibles, whether you have it in this form or whether you have it on your phones or your tablets. But let me encourage you to follow along, because this is important to understand the Word of God and how to find and navigate different passages in the Word of God. So, he possesses knowledge. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 9 through 11, listen to what Paul writes. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart of man imagined, what God has prepared for those who love him. Now, a lot of times people look at that and say, oh yeah, Paul's talking about heaven there. No, he's not. He's not talking about heaven in that context. And I'll tell you why in just a second as we read the rest of this. He says, these things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. So Paul's not talking about some type of mystical type of information or revelation that God is going to give us as we get into heaven, as we get into glory. No, this information he has revealed to us through the working of the Holy Spirit. He says, for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For who knows a person's thoughts except the Spirit of that person, which is in him? So also no one comprehends the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. So verse 10 tells us that the riches that Paul is referring to here in verse 9 is not heaven, although that's going to be great and glorious, right? But what Paul is talking about here are the glories of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and all of the love and all of the grace and all of the mercy and all the wisdom and all the spiritual power that is contained in the gospel presentation. This is what Paul is talking about here, and this is what the Holy Spirit has revealed to us. The Holy Spirit carries out the unique work of revelation in our lives through the process of illumination. So let's talk about what that means. Revelation is God revealing himself. We've been talking about that in our life group as we've been making our way through the book of Romans. So Revelation is when God reveals, and he does that through different ways. You look out that window, and you see the green grass that Brother Dave cut last week. It looks so beautiful out there. You look at the blue skies. You look at the trees. You look at all of those things. That's God's revelation. That is his created order. That is natural revelation. God has also given us special revelation through this precious book that we have in our hands today. He's given a special revelation through the incarnation of Jesus Christ, through dreams, through visions, through all of those things, angelic messengers. All of those are forms of special revelation that God has given us. But this revelation, beloved, and let me be very clear about this, this revelation is complete. While you hold in your hand is the 66 books of the Word of God, 39 books in the Old Testament, 27 books in the New Testament, they comprise and they make up what is referred to as the canon of Scripture. God's not going to add to this. God's done with this. What God wants to do with this book, however, in our lives is this process of illumination. As God speaks to our hearts through the Spirit, through the Word of God, what the Spirit of God does is that he gives us information and he gives us illumination from the pages of this book as the Holy Spirit teaches us things that he wants us to understand about himself. So illumination is when we grow, when we become more of the child of God that God wants us to become. That's what God does through illumination. But when we think about the work that the Spirit carries out in our lives, I want you to think about in terms of subtraction more than addition. As I mentioned, we're not going to get any more revelation than what God has given us in his Word. That is completed. God has finished that. But what God wants to do is to subtract some things out of our lives. What kind of things does God want to subtract out of our lives? What about sin? What about greed? What about pride? What about arrogance? What about lust? You see, these are the things that the Holy Spirit wants to subtract out of our lives. He wants to strip those things out of our lives, and thereby what he's doing is filling in with the things of the Spirit. You remember what Paul says, what the fruit of the Spirit are? There's love, grace, long-suffering, forbearance, all of those things that God wants to subtract out of our lives through the Holy Spirit's work, and then he wants to add these things into our lives that make us more shaped and revealed into the image of God's dear Son. So verse 11, it reminds us of 1 Corinthians 2, that unless the Holy Spirit reveals the truths to us, we don't get them. And this is the important ministry of the Holy Spirit, that he wants to reveal these things to us so that we understand what he's doing in our lives. So the Holy Spirit is a person. He possesses knowledge, but he also demonstrates love. He demonstrates love. In Romans chapter 15, verse 30, Paul writes the following. Now I urge you, brethren, by our Lord Jesus Christ and by the love of the Spirit, to strive together with me in your prayers to God for me. So here Paul emphasizes that the Holy Spirit produces love in the hearts of all those who are his. Let's go back to Trail's testimony. Let's go to TJ's testimony and perhaps many other of us who have testimonies in here. Why is it that at one time you were filled with hate and you were filled with disgust and you were filled with violence and you were filled with hostility? And why is it now after we come to know Jesus Christ, all of that's been taken away and now we have what? We have love. We have grace. We have mercy. Why is it that we are now fertilizer instead of what J.R. said that we were earlier? Right? What makes us fertilizer now instead of what we were? It is the grace of God. It is the love of God that now shines forth powerfully in our lives, that takes all of that hate, that takes all of that desperation and replaces it with the love of God. That's why we practice love, because we are God's people. And as God's people, love is demonstrated through our actions, through our words, through our attitudes, and through our obedience to God as he leads and directs us. But just as the Holy Spirit possesses knowledge and just as he demonstrates love, he can also be grieved. Did you realize that? The Bible teaches us that the Holy Spirit can be grieved. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30, listen to what Paul admonishes the Ephesians to understand and to avoid. He says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. The Holy Spirit can be grieved by our thoughtless words. Ever spoken any of those? We all have, haven't we? The Holy Spirit can be grieved by our disobedient actions. Anybody ever acted disobediently to the Spirit of God? Yeah. We all have, haven't we? The Holy Spirit can be grieved by our willful attitudes instead of a spirit of willingness where we are allowing God to work in our hearts. We can sometimes become very willful and stubborn and obstinate. And don't you believe that God's Spirit is grieved by those attitudes? Yes, He is. He certainly is. And so our carelessness in life and speech can strike at the very heart of the Spirit of God, and it grieves Him. Milton Agnew once wrote this. He says, only a dear friend can be grieved. Not a stranger, he might be annoyed. Not a chance acquaintance, he might be perplexed. Not a business partner, he might be offended. Only a loved one can be grieved. And beloved, as you and I know, the Spirit of God loves us, and He cares for us, and He can be grieved by us. But then the Holy Spirit also displays the actions of a person. What are the actions of a person? When you think about who you are, what makes you up as a person, what are the attributes or what are the characteristics that are manifested in you as a person? Well, He speaks. The Holy Spirit speaks. Listen to Revelation chapter 2, verse 7, where we're reminded that he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The question for me is not so much whether the Holy Spirit speaks. If the Word of God says He speaks, I'm going to just believe that. Amen? So the real question here is not whether the Holy Spirit is capable of speaking or that He does indeed speak. The question is, who's listening? That's the question, right? And I want you to understand that if the Holy Spirit is speaking to our hearts, there is an intent purpose behind that, and that is that we would listen. C.S. Lewis used to talk about his dog. He said, my dog never really did obey me. He just happened to agree with me at times. May that not be the testimony of God's people. Because our role, our purpose is to listen to the Spirit of God and not just decide whether I'm going to obey Him because I happen to agree with Him this time, but to so much be in love with Him and so much be attuned to His voice and His power in our lives is that when He speaks, we don't have any questions. We just say, yes, Father, I may not understand what You're doing here, but I trust You and I'm going to do what You ask me to do. When You speak, I will listen. And then I will act. The Bible also tells us that the Holy Spirit cries out in our hearts. In Galatians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7, Paul reminds his Galatian readers of this. He says, and because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father, so you are no longer a slave, but a son, and if a son, then an heir through God. So what is Paul telling us? He's telling us that just as you and I have a father-son relationship with our children, or father-daughter relationship. That's the kind of relationship that God wants to have with us. And I want you to understand something in this too, and that God doesn't want us in bondage. God doesn't want us in bondage. That's why we can talk about being freed from the bondages of addiction. That's why we can talk about being freed from the bondages of reason. Some of those cages have all kinds of treats, but they're still a cage nonetheless. And then in our lives, there are a lot of things that we get involved in that we become in bondage to. And at first sight, they look like they have a lot of the glamour, and they have a lot of the glitz, they have a lot of the bling. But when you boil it all down to its basic essential, you're still encaged. You're still in bondage. No matter how pretty the cage, no matter how fancy the cage, you're still in bondage. And the Holy Spirit is in the work of freeing us and making us free children of God. But then here's one, too, that's always an enjoyable thought to me. And then it's the Holy Spirit intercedes. In Romans chapter 8, verses 26 and 27, we many times hear this passage. By the way, Romans 8 is one of those powerful, powerful passages that tells us so much about the love of God and tells us about being transformed through the image of God. That great verse that we often look to in times of tragedy is that all things work together for good of those who love God, who are called according to His purpose. But sometimes we miss this idea that in the midst of our conflict, in the midst of our tragedy, there is a Holy Spirit who intervenes for us and intercedes for us. And so listen to what Paul says in Romans 8. He says, in the same way, the Spirit also helps our weakness. For we do not know how to pray as we should. Ever been there? Ever been in a situation? Ever been dealing with circumstances in your life and you started saying, God, I need to pray about this, but I don't even know where to begin. I don't even know what to say here, God. I have no idea what I need to pray for at this time, but God, I just know I need help. Well, I want you to understand, when you and I feel that way, there's somebody who knows exactly what we need. There's someone who knows exactly what you're going through. This is why we sing that song a little while ago, that God is for us. He is a good, good Father, and our good, good Father has given us a good, good Holy Spirit. And so the Holy Spirit comes, as Paul says here. He says, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And He who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because He intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. By the way, you are never, ever alone. You are never, ever desolated. You are never, ever abandoned as a child of God. By the way, the Greek word translated intercede that is used here in this passage is the only time that this word is used in the entire New Testament, right here in Romans chapter 8. And you know what the word means? The word means Spirit intercedes for us on earth, and who is indwelling us. What a powerful concept. Jesus Christ is our intercessor as he sits at the right hand of the Father, but the Holy Spirit who indwells us is an intercessor for us as He intercedes for us here on earth. Paul tells us the Holy Spirit intercedes for us in groanings that we may not understand, but fortunately He does. He knows what He's doing, what He's saying. But then there's another human attribute that the Holy Spirit has, and that is He teaches. I love this one, because I like to learn, I like to teach, and this one really excites me, because in John chapter 14, verse 26, this is what Jesus tells us about the teaching ministry of the Spirit. He says, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in My name, He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I said to you. Isn't that cool? That God, the Holy Spirit, is there to teach us. By the way, who's the greatest teacher of the Word of God? Not Matthew Henry. Not Barnes Notes, not any of those great writers, and many of them I respect, and many of them I have their books and read after, but the greatest teacher of all, the greatest commentator of all on Scripture is the Holy Spirit. You know why? Because He's the one who inspired it, so He should know what He wants to teach us, doesn't He? So He is the teacher. He teaches us what Jesus didn't even teach us during His earthly ministry. So He teaches. But then He also leads. He leads. In Romans chapter 8, verse 14, listen to what Paul again reminds us, though, because God wants to use that, but also wants to sanctify our thought processes. Some of us have needed some sanctifying in our thought processes in the past, right? So as He sanctifies our thought processes, then that works in tandem with the leadership of the Holy Spirit, and we are able to pick up on what God is doing, and we're able to follow that. One of my favorite writers, Henry Blackaby, many of you have heard of him. He wrote Experiencing God. But he also wrote a great book on spiritual leadership. I'd recommend it to anyone who's interested in leadership. But Henry Blackaby, in his book on spiritual leadership, said this. He says, if we work in the power of our strength, we will reap the benefits of what our strength can produce. But if we work in the power of the Spirit, we will reap the benefits of what the Spirit can produce. So the question for you and I is, whose power are we going to work in? Do you want to work in your power? I don't. I've worked in my power long enough. And I can tell you what my power derives is less than what I would want to see oftentimes. So I don't want to work in my power. I want to work in the Spirit's power. Because the Spirit is all powerful. He has all authority. He has all of the power that is needed to do what God wants us to do in this current life. But then here's the last attribute of the Spirit that we'll look at today. And I really like this one too. This one excites me. And that is, he exercises authority over the church. He exercises authority over the church. Can I tell you this right now? I'm not the authority over this church. These elders are not the authority over this church. There's not a clique that's the authority over this church. There's not a group that's the authority over this church. Sometimes you all walk out, and I'm thankful, and I'm very humble about this, but a lot of times you guys will walk out and say, Pastor, great sermon this morning, great message this morning, and I appreciate that. But some of you, I've told you, I just want to get out of God's way. If I can get out of God's way, then God can do what he wants to do. If I get in the way, then I'm not going to accomplish anything, and you're not going to benefit from it. So I'm just trying to get out of God's way. Because I found if I'm out of God's way, then God has full access and full reign to do what he wants to do in our lives. And God, the Holy Spirit, exercises authority over the church. You know, let me share with you an example of this that's found in the book of Acts. The Acts of the Apostles, which really I think should be called the Acts of the Holy Spirit. Because in Acts chapter 13, verse 2, what you see here is that while they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, again, we talked about that attribute really already, right? He said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. For folks who like predictability in their worship services, they wouldn't have liked worshiping with the early New Testament church. I've been to some churches where if you didn't have the bulletin, and you didn't go by the bulletin, then you were anathema. You know, you're just shot. And we have this order of service that we have to go by. And you can't deviate away from the order of service, because God help you if you deviate away from the order of service. I had a pastor friend tell me that at the church he pastored, they put a screen. And he used to have a little notepad, or like an iPad or something. He uses his mouse. And one of his members came up to him and said, Pastor, you going to use that mouse thing this morning in your sermon? He says, well, I'm planning to. Well, then I'm not going to stay. I'm going to leave because I'm against it. So that's the way people are, but that's kind of silly, isn't it? Because if I get myself out of the way, if we get ourselves out of the way, we recognize that the Holy Spirit has control over the worship services of our churches. Now, to a lot of us, that feels like chaos. To a lot of us, that sounds like disorder. And you know, too, from what Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 14, God is not the author of confusion. Okay? So whatever the Holy Spirit does, he's going to do it in a way that is consistent with the Holy Spirit's working in our lives. But if you like predictability, you're probably not going to like the Holy Spirit bumping into your service and interrupting your services. But that's exactly what he did here. But you want to know why I think the Holy Spirit could do that there? Well, it's because where they were. It wasn't about where they were geographically. It was about where they were spiritually. They were worshiping and they were fasting, which tells me that their hearts and their minds were set and directed toward God, not their order of service. That their hearts and their minds were directed Godward, not toward their bulletins or their traditions. That they were directed toward the Spirit of God. And when our hearts are directed toward the Spirit of God in worship and in fasting, then God feels quite comfortable to come in and says, hey, guys, let me interrupt here just a second. There's something I want to do. And we can allow him to do that. But here's what strikes me about this encounter. Because what the Holy Spirit did, he says, I want to separate Paul and Barnabas because I want them to go out and do this missionary work. This is where God calls them. And so from here on out, you see them leaving this church, and they're going out doing the work of evangelism. They're doing the work of a missionary. They're establishing churches. A lot of churches look at that and say, hey, I don't want you to do that. And yet that's what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be sending people out. As you grow and as you mature and as you develop, we're supposed to be sending you out to do the work of God. And so this is what they did. But two things about this church strike me as being significant. First of all, the church was prepared for and welcomed the Holy Spirit's presence and direction. This is the first thing that strikes me, because they were prepared for that. They were ready for that. And they wanted to be there, and they allowed the Spirit to be a part of that service. But then secondly, the church acted quickly and in keeping with what the Holy Spirit directed them to do. And you see this in verse 3. It says, then when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. So it wasn't about deliberating. It wasn't about having counseling sessions with them and saying, are you really sure the Holy Spirit's calling you to do this? They accepted what the Holy Spirit did, and then they acted quickly in what they did. Can I just make this last statement? How effective and fruitful the church would be if we were that open and responsive to the Spirit of God. Can you just imagine what the Church of Jesus Christ could do? Can you imagine what LifePoint could do if we were that open, that receptive, and that responsive to the Spirit of the living God? We'd be evangelizing this place like crazy. We'd be reaching out, and the Holy Spirit would be doing things, calling people out, starting ministries, and doing all kinds of stuff that God wants to do as a result of his people being open and responsive to him. That's what he wants to do. Who is the Holy Spirit? He's someone who has human manifestations, but he is the living God, the third member of the triune Godhead. Let me close with this story. Gordon Brownville wrote a book called The Symbols of the Holy Spirit, and he talks about the great Norwegian explorer Roald Amundsen. Amundsen was the first to discover the magnetic meridian of the North Pole, and he was the first to discover the South Pole. I guess he liked cool climates. But on one of his trips, Amundsen took a homing pigeon. And when he finally reached the top of the world, he opened this bird's cage and he released this homing pigeon, set it free. And I want you to imagine the delight of Amundsen's wife back in Norway when she looked up from the doorway of her home and saw this pigeon circling in the sky above her. No doubt, she exclaimed, he's alive. My husband is still alive. Because that homing pigeon was the evidence of her husband's existence and continued life. And beloved, can I tell you this? That so it was when Jesus ascended. Jesus was gone. But the disciples hung to his promise that he was going to send them the Holy Spirit. And imagine what joy then when the Holy Spirit descended at Pentecost that these disciples experienced, because they could understand and exclaim, like Amundsen's wife, he's alive. And he sent us the Spirit to demonstrate his truth and to demonstrate his power. And beloved, what we want to do is to allow the Spirit to continue to do his work in our lives today, because he lives. Jesus lives. And he has given us the Holy Spirit to demonstrate that he is alive and he is working in this world around us. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your word, and thank you for the attention of your people this morning. And God, we just pray that you would minister to our hearts now through this time of invitation. Lord, may your Spirit dwell richly and powerfully. And Lord, we pray that if there's someone here today who doesn't know Jesus as Savior, that today would be the day that they come to know Him. Father, for those of us as Christians, I pray that You would draw us into a closer connection with You, Lord, that You would illuminate our hearts, illuminate our minds, God, and do that work of spiritual renovation and spiritual rejuvenation in our hearts. We ask it in Jesus' name. I'm going to ask you to stand with me this morning as our praise team leads us in our final hymn of invitation. If God has spoken to your heart this morning, would you leave your seat and make your way up here and let someone take God's word and show you this morning how you can have that need met in your life. As our praise team leads us, would you come?
In His presence.